Thank you very much, Dilip. Mr. Rashish Shah, Mr. Somani, Mrs. Reddy, the past presidents of FICCI and leaders of the industry and other members of FICCI present in this year's AGM. Thank you very much, Mr. Shah, for inviting me once again to speak at the annual general meeting of the FICCI itself. Some FICCI presidents of the past have been luckier than you because they've worked during peaceful periods. It's said that either the oil producers or the financial market players are capable of causing disruptions today. And I think it was only appropriate to have a financial market leader as the head of FICCI, though he was not the cause of the trouble. And therefore, you rightly decided now to concentrate on the real economy and get a manufacturing sector man as your next head. But last year, you are right, was indeed a very challenging year. It was challenging because one normally expects the world's largest economy to be a stabilizing factor. A stabilizing factor on global economy, a stabilizing factor on various multilateral organizations. But that didn't happen. The second important fact itself was that the spillovers of policies of some countries did impact the rest of the world. In some way, we were also impacted. The trade war, we don't know how long it will last. But its initial impact was on shaking up, particularly our currencies to some extent. The oil prices, obviously, had a direct adverse impact on us. India is a net buyer of oil, and therefore, there is a particular level up to which India has a resistance capacity. And that resistance capacity, once it's breached, then obviously it can add to inflation as far as the common man is concerned. It can add to our current account deficits. It can therefore start impacting our currencies adversely. We saw some measure of it. And then, of course, the last thing that we want is that when these global challenges stare us in the face, at least our internal domestic capacity has to be strengthened in order to put up a resistance. And Indian economy now is fairly large, as your graphs just indicated, for us to display a certain level of resilience itself. And therefore left to ourselves our capacity as resilience is fairly high. And therefore, notwithstanding all these adverse global trends where the IMF forecasts a slight slowdown in the world, we still maintain our position as the fastest amongst the major economies in terms of our growth. Our ability to be within that 7 to 8% range is fairly certain. Though I see many comments to the contrary, but I am reasonably certain that even in this year, despite all the odds, we'll be able to maintain our fiscal targets. Because when current account deficits are impacted by the oil prices and the strengthening dollar, the last thing that India can afford is to run itself into a twin deficit situation. Because the fallouts of that itself will be very serious. And of course, our inflation again is under control. And if we compare it for the period 2009 to 2014, UPA 2, the average rate of inflation during those 5 years was 10.4%. And therefore, to be at 2.3% now and around 3.5% on an annual average. And that, I think, has been broadly the range of the five-year average itself. And now that we have a monetary policy committee and a statutory inflation targeting, I think we've kept ourselves within that range. In fact, we've kept ourselves to the lower part of that range itself. To that extent, we can get some satisfaction. But then I can tell you where you are handing over the baton to Mr. Somani, and I indicated that the last thing that we want is to manufacture a domestic problem so that our resilience to this global crisis itself dilutes itself. And therefore, we next 6 months particularly, I think in terms of the political rhetoric, are going to be very critical also for Indian economy. I do believe that a lot of what is going to be said and raised over the next 5 to 6 months by many may not be an expression of their real intention. But an economy which has set a target for itself to pull millions and millions of Indians out of poverty, to continuously aim to be the world's largest and fastest growing large economies, where over the course of the next few years, we intend to even overtake the United Kingdom and then come close to Japan in terms of our GDP, if not per capita, and then in the long run become a part of the big three, and then evolve into a developed country. And that's probably the subject of the new India that you have kept for this annual general meeting. And therefore, for people like you to flag what is sound policy as against transient populism will all the more become extremely important. And I see as two immediate challenges before us, and those two immediate challenges are, and as a financial sector player, Mr. Shah knows better than many of us, that we need to get out of the syndrome of difficulties in credit, improve the liquidity situations in the market, so that we don't manufacture a challenge for us which is otherwise capable of being tackled. And of course, the second, as I indicated, that even when the election year debate goes on, many like you will have to flag to different players in the political system the importance of sound policies and how they can be even blended with actually good politics. Dilip Shenoy just mentioned that we need over the next 10 years to maintain this position. 10 years may be a target in the medium term, but I would put it a little longer than that. Our immediate target, if we want to achieve that goal, has to be laid down for at least the next 2 decades. What is the kind of India that we envisage? There is one India which is completely changing. Attitudes are changing, entrepreneurship is growing, quality of life has significantly improved. And this has led to a demonstrative effect where many, many others are now aspiring for a better tomorrow. And therefore, if we maintain our current growth rates and our pivotal global position and attempt through a further process of reform, change and improvement to strengthen our systems, are we capable of getting out of this range of 7 to 8%? I quite foresee the difficulty that anything more than that is really possible, either if something spectacular was happening inside the country, particularly in the manufacturing sector, or if the global tailwinds were such that they push a higher growth rate across the world, as it happened during the 2003 to 2008 period. Currently, we must be realistic. If any of those two things or both were to happen, it would be a delightful opportunity for us. But assuming that doesn't happen, how do we try and get out of this range of 7 to 8%, which the world considers as a spectacular rate, but our level of ambition has been raised to an extent that we still consider it a moderate range. And therefore, I see nothing wrong in it, in India being more modest, India being impatient and wanting to grow at a much faster pace. In the first instance, we must remember that there are several unreformed sectors of the economy. These are unreformed because reforms are the art of the possible. You can't confront politics and then reform. And therefore, without stating what these unreformed sectors are, I think there is a serious challenge, and in the course of the year, I'll be too glad if you could look at it, as to what are these unreformed sectors of the economy. What do we do? I'll indicate two of them. People refer to education as the obvious third. What do we do with regard to state road transport, which the common man uses? Do we bring it up? We've experimented things in the aviation sector and we've seen how they've improved. On the roadways and the highway sector, we've seen how situations have improved, and in both the aviation and the roadway sector, we've become globally competitive. In fact, better than most places in the world. But have we done so in the matter of the state road transports? Have we done so in the matter of the railways? Now, you will obviously see where the potential for further reform activity in some of these sectors is capable of arising in future. And as I said, reforms are the art of the possible. Therefore, how do you do it? How do you build an opinion where people realize that they would benefit from a better quality of services provided to them? And then, of course, there is the continuous investment which we'll require in the urbanization process, the continuous investment we'll require in science and technology and research, and in our infrastructure. Many segments of our infrastructure are moving quite fast. In some of them, we've acquired a core competence. And a bare look at them without even analyzing the real data, the highways, the ports, the airports, the aviation. We've started doing extremely well in these sectors. But then the last thing we need to do is, in some of them, to not allow success stories to be converted for our reasons of our own aberrations into challenges for the economy. When the telecom sector players beat me and the aviation sector players beat me, these are both success stories. We can't afford to allow these success stories to be actually converted into challenges on the economy because of what's happening in the sectors itself. And if we look further and go beyond these sectors, creation of new cities takes decades. So we even started this whole business of suburbanization, because there is a big migration taking place from the rural areas where people suffered from underemployment. But there is a silver lining at that. And the silver lining is that performance of programs which are targeted now has gone up because of citizens' participation. Governments alone can't make them move. So how do you connect 33 crore people to bank accounts in a matter of few months? How do you ensure that under the Mudra system that you referred to, 13 crore individuals, 54% of them being women, and being women, it means it's a second income for that modest household, start benefiting out of this? If we look at today the speed of rural roads, it's an amazing speed at which they are being built. Another year or two from now, the connectivity to every village would be completed. And now you will have to look at inter-village connectivity itself, or making clusters of villages connected between themselves. Last year, in the rural housing, if we take 8 crore as the figure of the BPL families in India, who can't afford a rural house, last year we reached a target of 45 lakh homes in the village, rural areas in 1 year. This year it's likely to be 50 lakhs. So if we are able to do that speed of 50 lakhs plus per year, and there having been some people already covered by that scheme in the slower years in the past, so every Indian having a house, even the poorest of them, his house and village being connected by a road, it having electricity, it having a toilet. Now the speed of the toilet program, on 30th November I checked it, it had reached 96% rural sanitation, something which was unthinkable a couple of years ago. Cooking modes have changed in most of those houses. I checked up day before yesterday, because I was told in the Ayushman Bharat, in a period of two and a half months, 500,000, 5 lakh people have had free hospital treatment. That is the 10 crore families at the bottom of the ladder. So you are now reaching a situation where a reasonable level of growth gives you a reasonable level of revenue, coupled with all the steps we took. And amongst all the steps we took, they added to the expansion of the tax base, both in direct and indirect tax. And the advantage of that has been that whether for infrastructure or for any one of these poverty eradication programs, financial support is required. The exchequer is today able to bear it. And I have no doubt in the coming years, this capacity is only going to increase. And once that happens, you are going to have a much larger population, not only amongst the urban poor, but also amongst the rural poor, and some of them in rural areas where whom land can no longer feed, reaching a situation where they are going to move to the cities, they are going to go in for regular employment, and our economic system has to be ready to cater to all of them. And when these aspirations will occupy the center stage, then traditional problems which plagued India, social divides in the society, which used to become an instrument of political vulnerability, that will get replaced by your capacity at who's delivered how much. And I think, therefore, as a nation whose resilience is increasing, whose capacity is increasing, and if you are going to pull up all those people out of poverty and give them a better quality of life, coupled with the fact that you improve urban infrastructure, develop more urban areas, suburban areas, have a better highway system, a better connectivity system, a better telecom system. These are areas where we've hugely improved after the liberalization since 1991. And therefore, over the next two decades, if you target your present or higher levels of growth, unquestionably you'll be the world leaders as far as the growth is concerned. But in addition to being the world leaders, you could have brought in a lot more satisfaction and a lot more equity into the society. And that will probably become New India's greatest strength. If China dominated the global economy for 30 years on the strength of its low-cost manufacturing and its speed to execute its the speed with which it executed projects, then India's capacity will be not your present middle class, but a hugely expanded band of that middle class whose purchasing power is going to attract the world to India. And therefore, it's no longer not only an opportunity as far as the Indian entrepreneurs are concerned, because that's where the purchasing power is going to be, and therefore that's where people are going to put in their monies, but even investors from around the world. And people are already looking at us with that point. What is, however, lacking? Is the quality of public discourse in India and that discourse making this an enabler. And I think organizations like yours, which have a legacy of nine decades plus, really have to contribute to that public discourse itself. I clarified yesterday in a speech that I was delivering on a video link to Mumbai to an organization. The issue of the central bank and the government. Of course, the government respects the autonomy and independence. And because we respect the autonomy and independence of the central bank, that's precisely why we told them what is within your power and domain and your jurisdiction, please, these are the problems the markets are facing. I can't conceive how an elective sovereign government bringing to the notice and flagging the issue of credit and liquidity can in any way infringe the autonomy. I remember a very interesting incident where some of my senior friends in the legal profession told me. In fact, two, three of them still around, Mr. Sorabji, Ashok Desai. During the emergency, all the high courts decided in favor of the debt reduce. But when it went to the Supreme Court, considering the character of the court at that time, they were all worried. So all of them who were involved in that fight went to two of the veterans of that era, Mr. Daftari and Mr. Chagla, and said, we are very worried what the Supreme Court may do. The bench composition may be such that it decides against the citizen. So a delegation led by Mr. Daftari went to meet the Chief Justice and advised him that the bench must be of the most experienced people and the senior most people. He thought probably they may be pro-citizen. He proved wrong on that. But he went with that intention. So the Chief Justice said, well, that's my function. How do you interfere? He said, that's precisely why we've come to you. So if it's your function, the issue has to be flagged with you. That doesn't take away your powers. And therefore, if there is scarcity in the market, whoever is to deal with it, why alone the government? I think the FICCI should have gone to them. The CII should have gone to the concerned people, just as you come to us. And say, these are the challenges because we don't need in the current global situation another domestic challenge itself to be built up. And a communication and dialogue and bringing it to the notice of the empowered authority is a part of the manner in which the economic system is to work. Autonomy is not synonymous with isolationism. And that is why this whole debate in the public discourse went in a direction were telling the concerned institution that these are the issues to be flagged, and this is where the challenge has to be addressed, can't be an aberration. That's an absolute necessity. And I'm glad, I do hope things will work out well in future. And this doesn't only apply to these areas. And I think all those who are in the business of public communications and conveying them must seriously ponder. The Supreme Court judgment today on the defense transaction, what were we trying to do? If we look at and introspect seriously our resilience as a nation, post-Kargil, how much time did it take for our armed forces to get rid of a few hundred players who were on the hilltop or the mountaintop? Weeks, with considerable casualties. So doesn't our Air Force need combat aircrafts with a high combat ability so that you can fire in at the enemy and finish him from a distance? Or must you rely only in the remote technology of a gun in the valley aiming at people standing on a mountaintop? A 2003 decision, tendering, deciding, and in 2012, the government says the Rafale transaction is approved, but the procedure may be looked into once again. A yes and no government, neither here nor there. And then the attempt is, let's further delay it by another decade. Enemies won't wait for our decision-making process to be so long-winded. And that is where the quality of public discourse has to be considered in all its seriousness. And this applies across the board to all issues, particularly the issues which concern you, the Indian industry. And the big issue which you are going to face a challenge, and therefore don't get provoked by or upset by what happens in the course of the next few months, because I do believe that India still has a lot of responsible politics. And therefore, what is going to be stated in many cases may actually never happen. I've repeatedly said, India needs stability of policies to continue during this period that we have a lot of backlog to cover up with. Our stability of policy and direction, what is the Indian model? The Indian model which is now evolving is that you must have a fast-moving economy based on a certain set of market reforms that you carry out. There's never a finishing line in reforms. Reforms, depending on the challenge of the situation, may start emerging on a future date. And use the benefits for infrastructure creation, for improving the quality of healthcare, housing, education, and invest as much as you can into the India's poor. That's the sector which needs to be supported. And that model is that even if you have a market economy, it's an economy which has a social consciousness. And that's a model which is going to continue. And if that is going to continue, you need a decisive leadership. You can't have fragile coalitions, because at the end of the day, if one partner says, I can pull down the government if you don't declare my state as a special status, then those better off than him will say, or worse off than him will say, those worse off than him will say, if he can become, why not me? And you'd probably have half a dozen of them wanting a special status. So the policy direction will be that you probably will have a helpless center dependent on these kind of players. And what the framers of our, founders of our nation envisaged, that India, that is Bharat, which is a union of states, then ending up as a confederation of states. And that is the last thing that India can afford to happen. So you'll need policy clarity, you'll need policy stability, you'll need a policy stability and a directional stability which goes on for decades, and you'll need a decisive leadership which moves in that direction. And that is then going to create an economy which will be fast growing with various market reforms where entrepreneurship becomes a premium, but it also has a social consciousness that it supports the strength of the gets the strength of the economy to support the underprivileged and pull them up. I think if we were to maintain that direction, and that is where Mr. Somani's term may be free from the problems which financial market players had seen, but it probably will be a term where a lot of directional stability of India will have to be maintained. And I'm sure it will be a pleasure for everyone in the policy making parts of the government to interact under his leadership with the members of the FICCI. This interaction enriches all of us mutually, and I'm quite sure that in the coming years it will probably be strengthened even further. Thank you very much once again, and I wish you, Mr. Somani, all the very best in your term.